welcome my parents to Christ Lutheran Church. It was their great-granddaughter's first birthday party yesterday, and so we all got to celebrate. Got this question for you to discuss with the person beside you. What's your favorite movie and why? Go ahead and take a few moments to say what one of your favorite movies is and why. So think of your favorite movie and why you love it. Is it because it's action-oriented or a comedy, or is it because it's scary? Is it the plot? Is it the actor or actress? Some people would suggest that your favorite movie says something about you, something about your heart, something about your soul. An operational or occupational blessing, I will say, of being a pastor is when I see a movie, I see a series of message illustrations, and I'm always looking for like a good message illustration to use, and I thought that was just me, and then I read another pastor, his name's Adam Hamilton, he said this about them: they open our minds to new ideas and different perspectives with the power to spark emotions and inspire change. They help us make sense of our world and see ourselves in a new light. About 5 years ago, I wrote a book called Epic. It was by John Eldridge. This is what he said: what if all the great stories that have ever moved you brought you joy or tears? What if they're telling you something about the true story into which you were born, the epic into which you have been cast? And so for the last 4 Augusts, we've taken the month of August and we look at a series of movies, one each week, and how does it tie into God's big story, God's epic story? Sometimes movies do that intentionally. Most of the times they do it unintentionally because God's story is so great that people want to tell it. Whether they know it or not, that they want to tell it. And this morning we look at Beauty and the Beast, made in 1991, an animated classic. It was the first animated movie to be nominated for Oscar for Best Picture. And this is like when they only nominated 5, not the watered down 10 right now, but 5. Tell the person beside you if you have any idea what won that year. It wasn't Beauty and the Beast. Silence of the Lambs. That's what I said. Been saying it for 26 years now. Horrible choice. Beauty and the Beast made twice as much movie as Silence of the Lambs that year. They came out with a Broadway musical. How many of you saw the Broadway musical? Okay. We saw it in San Diego when we first got here in the upper, whatever the top upper deck is of the Symphony Hall. It sounded wonderful, I can tell you. I couldn't see much action going on. On Broadway, it was the 10th longest Broadway show in history. This past year, they came out with the live version of it, Disney did. How many of you saw that one? Obviously. 10th best-selling movie of all time. And the story? The story had been told in 4 different movie types before Beauty and the Beast was made in 1991. They date the story or some version of it to thousands of years before Jesus. The version that's told in the 1991 animated version, that goes to like 7th century France. It's got this amazing story. In the Berkey household, it is beloved because when we saw it in 1991, our youngest daughter, Dana, was 2.5 years old, and when Belle came out on the screen, she kept yelling, "It's me! It's me! It's me!" And so it's always had a special place in our heart. Why look at it today? Beauty and the Beast tells, unintentionally, I think, tells the story of the power of the curse of sin and how we get to a resurrection transformation. And in the middle there is an act of sacrificial love that touches and transforms lives. If you look at your message insert in your order of service, I invite you to take notes this morning as well as use this week's Grow, Pray, Study guide. You'll see on page 1 there is printed this verse from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. Join me in reading this verse together. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has gone, the new has come. Before we dig into God's word and the story told in this movie, let's go to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your epic story at work in our lives. Holy Spirit, today as we dig into your word and the story of Beauty and the Beast, open our hearts to see the new creation you make us, experiencing love's resurrection power. We praise you, Lord Jesus. You came as the beauty of heaven to us beasts here on earth, and you make all things new. In your name I pray. Amen. So Beauty and the Beast starts with the power of a curse and ends up with the transforming power that a resurrection can bring. This morning we'll look at three scenes from the movie, kind of the opening scene, the closing scene, and one kind of smack dab in the middle, and they tell the story. The first scene talks about the power of a curse. The second scene will talk about the power of sacrificial love. And the third scene, which is my absolute favorite in any movie, is this idea of resurrection transformation, of what happens when new life kicks in. What happens in the biblical sense of what God can do for you and for me. And so we're going to look at love's resurrection power as it's told in this story, but even more as it's told in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. You might think of this as a visual parable or story of what Paul is writing about. The big question is, who could ever love a beast? That's what scene one is all about. And it's the opening scene of the movie. Please watch.
Once upon a time, in a faraway land, a young prince lived in a shining castle. Although he had everything his heart desired, the prince was spoiled, selfish, and unkind. But then, one winter's night, an old beggar woman came to the castle and offered him a single rose in return for shelter from the bitter cold. Repulsed by her haggard appearance, the prince sneered at the gift and turned the old woman away. But she warned him not to be deceived by appearances, for beauty is found within. And when he dismissed her again, the old woman's ugliness melted away to reveal a beautiful enchantress. The prince tried to apologize, but it was too late, for she had seen that there was no love in his heart. And as punishment, she transformed him into a hideous beast and placed a powerful spell on the castle and all who lived there. Ashamed of his monstrous form, the beast concealed himself inside his castle with a magic mirror as his only window to the outside world. The rose she had offered was truly an enchanted rose which would bloom until his 21st year. If he could learn to love another and earn her love in return by the time the last petal fell, then the spell would be broken. If not, he would be doomed to remain a beast for all time. As the years passed, he fell into despair and lost all hope. For who could ever learn to love a beast?
As a prince, although he had everything, he was selfish, spoiled, unkind, incapable to love. And the curse, the beast that was inside of him, became his outward physical appearance. Let's face it, you've met the beast. Might have been a bully at school, or the mean girl, or a bad manager at work, or perhaps the scariest beast of all. The one you saw this morning in the bathroom mirror. And who could ever learn to love a beast? The challenge of the curse, though, is it doesn't just affect him. It affects his servants as well. They go from being human beings into human doings. Instead of being defined by who they are, they become defined by what they do. Cogsworth becomes a clock. Lumiere becomes a candelabra. Just think what that might be for you. What would you turn into if you were defined by what you do instead of who you are? It's the danger of the curse. And who could ever learn to love a beast? Well, the Bible tells us our own beauty and beast story. Look what Paul says here in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 14 and 15. For Christ's love compels us. Just circle that phrase. For Christ's love compels us. Because we are convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. And he died for all that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again. Christ's love saves us. Christ's love compels us. The connection to scene one here is this. Love's resurrection power. Love just has an incredible power that's at work in this story, but in the story of our lives as well. In the Beauty and the Beast story, the way that Beauty gets to the Beast is through her father. Her father is an inventor. He goes to a village, and he's traveling there to sell an invention. A storm hits. He gets lost, and when Maurice is lost, he ends up in the Beast's castle by mistake. And the Beast considers him a trespasser and throws him into a dungeon cell. The horse, Philippe, goes back to Belle in the village, and Belle figures out that Dad's lost and kind of coaxes the horse to lead her to where her father is. And when she gets to that castle and gets down to where her father is in that dungeon, she recognizes that her father is cold and is ill and is dying. And something needs to happen. When the Beast shows up, he says that Maurice is his prisoner, and Belle comes up with a plan to save her dad. I will take his place. I will make the sacrifice. I will be the substitute for my dad. When you think of the story of the Bible and you think of the story of Jesus, Belle kind of represents that. A sacrifice, a substitution, a redemption. When Jesus comes, he comes to take our place. Jesus' love is for us, for you and for me, and in three ways, Belle kind of mirrors what Jesus does. Let me share what Jesus did. Jesus took the punishment for our sin. Belle takes the punishment for her father for trespassing. Jesus goes into debt because we were sold into slavery to sin. He's the one that pays the price. Belle will pay the price with her life being there. And number three, Jesus' death communicates the depth of God's love for you and me. And that's really the driving power of this story here. Belle makes a sacrifice to express love for her father. So for Belle, love for father exceeds love for self. And at the start of the movie, for the Beast, or for that prince, love for self exceeds love for anybody else. And the story of the Bible, well, it's a story of great love. And the Beast is so moved by this act of love, it helps him to grow in his love. A little bit later in the movie, Belle's fed up with the Beast and because of his anger, and she runs away. And she's attacked by a pack of wolves. And all of a sudden, the Beast shows up and sacrifices his own safety to protect her. He has seen an act of sacrificial love that moves him to reach out and to help her. And something happens in the movie. The story continues. They see each other in a new light. Instead of just fear, there's now a hint of faith. Instead of hatred, there's the beginning of love. And that love changes the Beast. And in scene two, it's a scene of greater love. The Beast sacrifices his chance to let Belle go. In the second scene, that's what happens. So they have the big ballroom scene, and then afterwards, the Beast is moved to show some act of kindness, some act of love to Belle. And he says, is there anything I can do for you? Is there anything you would desire? She speaks of missing her father and just wishing that she could see him for just a moment. And he comes up with a plan with a magic mirror. And then he does an act of sacrifice. I'll watch this 2-minute clip.
This mirror will show you anything. Anything you wish to see.
I'd like to see my father, please. Papa! No. He's sick. He may be dying, and he's all alone.
Then you must go to him.
What did you say?
I release you. You're no longer my prisoner.
You mean I'm free?
Yes.
Oh, thank you. Hold on, Papa. I'm on my way.
Take it with you, so you'll always have a way to look back and remember me.
Thank you for understanding how much he needs me.
Well, Your Highness, I must say everything is going just swimmingly. I knew you had it in you.
I let her go.
Yes, yes. Splendid. You. What? How could you do that?
I had to.
Yes, but why?
Because I love her.
He did what?
Yes. I'm afraid it's true.
He's going away?
But he was so close.
After all this time, he's finally learned to love.
That's it, then. That should break the spell.
But it's not enough. She has to love him in return.
Now it's too late.
She's kind of their last hope. If the servants could have saved the beast and themselves, they would have. But they couldn't. Their hope is in her. For a decade they've been like this, and the petals are starting to drop. He's about to turn 21, and then it'll become a permanent situation. And he makes an act of sacrificial love. Love is demonstrated by letting go. By letting go of his own preference, by letting go of his own hope, by even letting go of his servant's hope. He sacrifices what he wants, what even he needs, that she might love her father. He's been moved by her sacrifice of love. That moves him to let go. Look how our story continues here in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 16. So from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. But Paul reminds us to let go of any prejudice in love. When Jesus came, he came for everybody. He came to give his life that all people might be here. In compelling love, Jesus lets go of heaven to come to earth. In compelling love, Jesus lets go of his life on a cross that we might have life with God. Love lets go. Love is moved forward. Resurrection love compels us. And the connection here in connection two is love's resurrection power grows our capacity to love. That's kind of the interesting pathway of the beast. Someone who cannot even show hospitality in love grows in his capacity to love as the movie goes forward. That's really my question for you today. Where do you need to grow in your capacity to love? Where does sacrifice need to replace selfishness? Where do you need to let go so that a relationship might grow stronger? Love is letting go. And that teaches us to grow in our life of love. In the third scene, we see that resurrection equals transformation. It really is my favorite scenes in movies is when they get this idea that a resurrection happens, that new life can begin. And that's especially true at the end of Beauty and the Beast. The opening question was, who could ever learn to love a beast? And we discover that Belle starts to have that love, but she leaves. And for most people in real life, that's kind of how the story plays out. We had hoped, and then it didn't turn out. Even Jesus' disciples feel that way. When Jesus died, they figure it's all over. They're not ready for a resurrection. And in this movie, in this story, that's where the beast is. That's where the servant is. And the concluding scene that we'll see is about 3 minutes long. The castle's under attack from the village. A man named Gaston, who looks beautiful on the outside but is the ultimate beast within, comes to kill the beast. And at one point, he's almost ready to do that, and he slips. He's about to fall to his death. And in compassion, the beast reaches out to help him. And he tells him to get out of his castle. But instead of doing that, Gaston grabs something and stabs the beast in the side. He's dying. He even appears that he's dead. Watch what happens next.
Please, please don't leave me. I love you. It is a miracle. In this case, by Disney magic. But what we saw this morning, it is a miracle. By the power of the Holy Spirit, what God can do in simple water with the power of His Word, it is a miracle. By divine act, Jesus conquers death and rises again. Look again at 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has gone. The new has come. At times, we are overwhelmed by the grief of death, and we forget the power of Easter and the joy of resurrected life, of what God has called us to do. It turns out that Christ's love compels us, and Christ's love calls us to sacrifice. But Christ's love calls us to come back as well. Jesus comes back
for you and for me. Jesus comes back and meets us in our baptism. The third connection is this. Love's resurrection power transforms us for now and for all eternity. In Beauty and the Beast, love comes back. Belle thought she got there too late. It turns out she gets there just in time. She comes back and the expression of love just relieves the curse, takes it away, and resurrection happens. Lives are transformed. In our Beauty and the Beast story of what God does in our lives, that's a story that's meant for us personally. But it's also a story that's meant to be shared. Look what Paul says here in verses 20 and 21. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God was making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Love finds its full expression in Jesus Christ. We understand that as followers of Christ. And yet that full expression is meant to be found in us and through us to touch the lives of other people. That love compels us. That love calls us to let go. And that love calls us to come back. To come back into relationships, to rebuild them, to tell this great story of we were beasts and God made us into beauties. And here's the deal. The one with no sin took our sin. He made the sweet swap. He took what was wrong in us and what was evil and what was the beast in us, and he turns us into God's beauties, the beauty that God made you and me to be. And he sends us out as his ambassadors with this very simple message. God loves you personally. God loves you relentlessly. God loves you personally. He knows the beast inside you and me better than we do. And still he loves us. And still Jesus came. And God loves you relentlessly. He will not let go. He will meet you in the waters of baptism. He will meet you in your beastly moments. He will meet you with the power of Jesus' love and transform us now and for all eternity. We bow our heads to pray. Thank you, God, for knowing us personally and still loving us relentlessly. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your sacrificial love that transforms us. Holy Spirit, compel us with Christ's love to know when we need to let go and when we need to come back. We praise you, O God, for your resurrection plan to free us from the curse of sin and turns us from beasts into the beautiful people you made each of us to be. And all God's people said, Amen.